Hi everyone, so glad I could be here. My name is David Breneel. I'm leading the responsible AI practice for Belgium and Luxembourg. I'm a consultant, and I'm so sad to hear that Thierry doesn't believe consultants are sexy anymore. So I hope to tell the difference here. What I'm going to talk to you about tonight is the last thing we should be doing with artificial intelligence, which is let it take decisions about our lives. Technology is great, this little device is really great, but there's a dark side to technology as well. And that's where I want to highlight a bit what are those dark sides, and how can you move actually to the bright side, to the Jedi side. What better way to do so than starting off with a couple of examples? First one I want to give is Amazon, if you're a woman. And a couple of years ago, you would be applying for a job at Amazon, there's a high chance that you would be discriminated. Because basically, they had an AI recruitment tool that was automating the process of recruiting people, and they trained that based on internal data. Now, if you know that 60 to 80% of the employees at Amazon are male people, for an algorithm, it's quite obvious to then pick the male in front of the female. Second example, anyone of you that sometimes forget to pay their bills on time? Then I have some bad news for you, because actually employers are now already considering taking your credit score into consideration to actually validate if you're a good employee or not. Because if you pay your bills on time, that basically means that you're punctual, that you're going to follow the rules. If you don't, then you're not reliable. So if you're out of a job, you're looking for a new one, forget to pay your bills, then it's going to be pretty difficult to find a new job for that. And it's a vicious circle, because every time you're out of a job, you don't pay your bills, you get actually into a downward spiral, and we create dropouts of society. Now let's take a look at Sarah. Sarah is a teacher in Washington, D.C., and Sarah got fired by an algorithm. Back in 2012, Washington, D.C., they were facing an issue with students that were not performing well. So they had about 50% of the 15 years old were not graduating to the next year, and about 8% of the 14 years old were not at level on mathematics and language. So basically what the city of Washington, D.C., they believe that, okay, the fact that children are not performing well is because the teachers are not being effective. So they created an algorithm that would actually score the effectiveness of teachers on the performance of children. By having a yearly test of the children's taking on mathematics and language, they would assess the positive or negative impact of a teacher on that test. Sounds obvious, right? Would you trust this algorithm to take a decision about your job tomorrow? I wouldn't. And that's the entire problem with the three examples I gave. It's all about trust. So what does it take to trust someone? What does it take to trust a person? Let's picture yourself that you're falling down, and you picture yourself in the place of the woman. What does it take to actually trust the person that's going to catch you? Any ideas? No? You basically want that person, if he says he'll catch you, that he's going to do it. He needs to be honest. You also want to make sure that he's going to do everything in his power to make sure that you don't fall on the ground. You want him to be reliable. But those are all fuzzy things, so how can we actually measure that an algorithm, which is going to take a decision about your life, is trustworthy? We do that by assessing four things. First one would be fairness. And this is applicable for trusting humans, trusting algorithms. It's the same thing if you want to trust someone. Is that person going to discriminate me or not? Is that person going to treat me different compared to another person? Is he going to treat me fair in every way? Is he transparent? Is he indeed claiming who he's pretending to be? Or is he actually lying to me? Same for an algorithm. Is it a black box or not? Is it accountable? Who is going to take accountability for the actions that were taken by the algorithm, for the fact that Sarah has been fired? Who's accountable for that? For the fact that women won't get a job at Amazon? Who's accountable? Is it a machine? Is it an algorithm? Or is it a person? Agency, this is all about control. Do we have, as people, have control over what decisions are being taken by algorithms? Will our opinion count? Can we provide feedback to those algorithms or not? So those are four important elements to evaluate when it comes down to interacting with artificial intelligence, building into artificial intelligence solutions and algorithms. Now, when we come back to the example of Sarah, what does it mean? Where did it go wrong? Fairness. Was the algorithm they built fair? Was it fair for the students? Basically, if you picture yourself a classroom of 20 to 25 children, these are all children with a lot of diversity, coming from different social economic backgrounds, coming from with different learning abilities. Some children have families that have financial issues. Some families have actually moved to another city, causing the child to actually lose all its friends. Another child is being bullied at school. This all has an impact, but it's so difficult to measure. And this is what we call social bias. And social bias is something which is embedded in the data that we collect to train our algorithms. And how can you measure this social bias? How can you measure that someone is being bullied through a simple mathematics test and a language test? It's just impossible. Was it fair that Sarah got fired because of this? Was Sarah treated fair? What they did is actually build an algorithm that would decide on you're a good teacher, you're a bad teacher, based on 20 children, data of 20 children. Statistically, this is unsound. You would never do that. As a data scientist, you need large quantities of data to ensure that all the exceptions are being balanced out and that the minorities are not being impacted. So if you want to have a fair AI solution, reduce your bias, make it assess your social bias, assess your measurement bias. Second aspect, was it transparent? Or was this algorithm complete black box? Did the people understand what the algorithm was doing? No, because teachers wondered themselves, why am I being fired? How does this algorithm actually have the idea to say that I'm a bad teacher, I'm a good teacher? What is right, what is wrong? If they asked the city and the developers to say, okay, can you explain me why I'm being fired? Then they basically said, yeah, that's quite difficult. It's an algorithm, you know, it's complex to explain that. So that's the answer that the teacher got. 200 teachers were fired over the course of 2 years, and the only answer they got was, I'm sorry, it was the algorithm deciding. And this is a real case. Huh? So it was not understandable, it was not explainable. The data they used was full of bias. And last but not least, agency. They didn't have control over it. There was no way that they could actually tell whether the algorithm took a good decision or a bad decision. They basically said, it's the algorithm that took a decision, it's going to be right. There was no control over it. There was no human in the picture that would help a machine tell if a decision was right or wrong. That's a complete mistake. And the last element on accountability, who was accountable in the end? What the city said, the city of Washington, D.C., sorry, teachers, we can't explain why you were fired. It's the algorithm deciding. Have you ever come across a racist computer? I haven't. You can't put technology to the blame of something that people have developed. In this case, I truly believe that in decision-making, it's a machine that should be helping humans. It's not machines that take over decision-making from humans. In any case. And why is that? Because we're evolving towards a society which is more human plus machine. It's we are helping machines to learn, to train, to give feedback, to ensure that they're improving on the decision-making. And they support us in that decision-making, but humans have the final say. And in the example of Sarah, what did they actually build? Was it to benefit society? No. They just built an algorithm to fire teachers, period. Instead, they could have built an algorithm that could help children to perform better in school, to become better in mathematics, better in language. They could have built an algorithm to make sure that the teachers were more effective in the job that they're doing. Instead, they went the negative side, they went the dark side. Some key takeaways, and I found this quite nice to put in the cinema screen. There's two sides to this, as I said. There's a dark side, you're going to be involved in a certain way. Either you're going to interact with artificial intelligence, with algorithms, or you're going to build it, or you're going to be part of an organization where AI solutions are built. Will you let these algorithms be built in a bad way that they're going to make a decision about human lives and impact, have a concrete impact to people's lives, being fired, not getting a job, becoming dropouts of society because you have a low credit score? Or do you choose to go to a light side and really think about the ethical consequences of the technology that we have in our hands and the solutions that we build? You have all the capacity and you have a choice to think critically about what we do with technology. You have a choice to think critically about what you give as data to organizations. Are they going to treat my data fair? Are they going to be transparent with what they do with my data? Are they going to build something that's beneficial for human society or not? You have a choice. Organizations should think about, when you create AI solutions, think of it as their own. Think of it as your baby in your organization. It should carry the values, the norms, the ethical principles, the code of conduct that you have in your organization. Why are people buying products? Because they're good products, they help you. So make sure when you build those AI solutions, they embed the same values and norms. And last, when you do that, make sure that you build it fair, make sure that you have transparency, and make sure that you do it with a human and machine plus machine mindset to create the trust, because that's what it's all about. So one last takeaway, if you're interested to read more about this, there's three excellent books I can recommend to you. Weapons of Mass Destruction by Cathy O'Neill, Life 3.0 by Max Tegmark, and Human Plus Machine by our CIO, Paul Daugherty. Thank you very much.